Foraging for food, foraging for medicine. What a radical concept in the 21st century, right? Yet perhaps this is exactly what our planet needs more of right now. More foragers, more active participants, not spectators, not analysts, not theorists, but active participants in this beautiful dance between Mother Earth and creature. Creature and Mother Earth. I've been coming to these meetings for a while now. I came to the very first meeting in October of 2013. We sat at a long table and we discussed the implications of biophilia, what it means to us. And I've been coming to a lot of meetings ever since. I usually sit right back in the corner. And you know, we talk a lot about how do we get people more involved with nature? How do we get people outside? How do we get people to care about the messes that some human beings are creating for all the other human beings out there? And yet it's interesting to me that very rarely, if ever, do we ever discuss something so obvious, something that humans have literally done for the majority of our time on this planet. That's foraging for food and foraging for medicine. This is a topic that I'm deeply passionate about. I'll never forget what it first did for me when I first got into it. So many years ago, when I first was introduced to this concept, what it did for me originally was it helped to tease apart this wall of green. And I think a lot of us know about this wall of green. It's easy to look outside and just get lost in it and just see trees, just see bushes, just see shrubs, just see plants, just see grass, and my favorite, to just see weeds. But within this wall of green is a vast and diverse ecosystem of countless species, many plants, many mushrooms, many of them edible, many of them medicinal. When I found this out and I was able to tease apart this wall of green, I went all in to where it's a passion of mine now. It's not a hobby. It's not an activity. It's not something I just dabble in. It's a passion. It is a lifestyle for me. It is something that is quite literally, and I don't mean this as a joke, I don't mean it to be taken lightly, but it's quite literally saved my life. And I mean that it has provided more guidance, more mentorship, more answers to questions that I didn't even know that I had. And I'm here to tell you, listen, if you are confused in any way, and let's face it, it's the 21st century, yes, it's a good time to live in, but it is a strange time to live in. There's a lot of weird things going on right now. I think if we were honest with ourselves, we would put some words to it, and we'd actually speak out about it. And a lot of us are confused, and you can see it out there. You look outside, and you see that confused look on people's faces. You ride the trolley, you ride the Port Authority bus, and you see the confused look on people's faces. You stand at the corner of Forbes and Murray, you go to a shopping mall and people aren't glued to their phones, a lot of them are confused. They put that down, you strip it away from them, just say, no, just sit still for a second. Then that confusion arises. If you ever feel that way, if you don't know what all this is for, if you're kind of lost, you just want some answers, pay attention tonight. Because the information that I'm about to share with you, if you follow it out, if you just don't write it down, I hope some of you write some things down. If you just don't write it down, if you just don't feel something, but if you live it, actually live it, it'll make all the difference, and you will be rewarded with more gifts than you knew you deserved. So many years ago, I remember vividly being asked this question, that million-dollar question. What do you want to do? It's a good question, whether you're 18 or 80, because nothing is static. It's always going to change. That's the way the universe works. It's always moving. It's dynamic. What do you want to do? And I remember the exact spot where people would ask me that question, where I was, what I was doing. I could tell you the names of those people if you want, but to a lot of it, it's irrelevant. And I remember coming to this one conclusion, this one answer. It just came out of me. And it was this. I just want to get people outside. I just want to take them into nature. And usually I was in the woods with somebody at the time. I just want to take them out there. I didn't know why. I didn't know if I wanted to teach them anything. I just knew I was feeling something. And I knew that they were feeling something different. I wanted to pull them out of the stressful habitats that they created for themselves and just bring them outside. Just watch that tension drop from their shoulders, drop from their soul. Be careful what you wish for, because dreams do come true. So now I lead a lot of foraging walks, workshops, classes, presentations throughout the year. It's what I do. People say, that's what you do? That can't be all you do. It's what I do. I lead all kinds of groups out. Doesn't matter who it is, doesn't matter what background they come from. So in the top left, I've taken out the Wilkinsburg Community Youth Group. I take out Mount Lebanon School District. I've taken out the UPMC Body Changers, a group of great individuals dedicated to healthy weight loss, and countless others. And we talk about all kinds of things, all good things. So right now, the spring greens are coming up. A lot of the wildflowers are out. Then we move into the perennial greens and the fruits, and then the fall fruits, and then the nut-bearing trees in the fall. The acorn. Anybody here an acorn eater? You ever eaten acorns before? That's great. You tried. Did you say you tried? What happened? Oh, when you're little. You haven't lived unless you've had acorn porridge. A little bit of maple syrup, a little bit of sea salt, sunflower seed butter, some service berries. You know, Pennsylvania, I think its greatest food is the acorn. Not wild food, but its greatest food is the acorn. You know, it's interesting. People from out of town come here and say, where's a good place to eat? You know, they're out of state. So we say, Permanis. Of course they're doing it. Think of something more creative than Permanis. Everybody says Permanis. I'm sure it's a great place, but everybody says Permanis. You're on the east side of the state, they probably say Philly cheesesteak or the Waffle House down the street or the Thai restaurant. You come to me, I say, go to that red oak tree up on the top of that hill. Quercus rubra up there. That 100-year-old tree is dropping 100 pounds of acorns right now. But we don't just talk about food and medicine. That's not what it's all about. When I get people out into the woods, we talk about the topography of the land. Why are certain species up here? Why are some down here? Why do beech trees have smooth bark? And all those other trees, the cherry tree, the shagbark hickory, the oak trees, they've got rigid furrow bark. What's going on with that? What's going on with the hemlock trees today? The hemlock woolly adelgids having a feast on our state tree right now. Is it the worst thing in the world, though? 5,000 years ago, the hemlock trees were nearly wiped out. That's what Harvard researchers say. They came back. They're strong. They're resilient. We talk about poison ivy. You can't eat poison ivy. Don't even try to eat poison ivy. Because some people have eaten poison ivy, but you're not going to do it. It's a teacher plant. People say, why do you like poison ivy? I love poison ivy because it teaches you to be present. When you're out in the woods, you can't just be moseying around like it's your backyard, like it's your bedroom, like it's a shopping mall. You have to be out there with intention. Yes, there's a time and place for moseying around in the woods, but if you're not careful, it's going to make its presence known. Nettles will make their presence known before you even see it. We talk about invasives. You know, everybody loves to hate on the invasives, but why not address those underlying conditions? Why aren't the native plants actually thriving? What have we done to the land? Why is it so damaged? Why is it so disturbed? What's allowing these invasives to come in? We can pull all we want, but we also have to address what's going on with that land underneath. We talk about Japanese barberry. Some of you know Japanese barberry. Some people love it, some people hate it. You can actually eat those fruits of Japanese barberry. You can eat the leaves, but perhaps the roots contain the most powerful antibiotic in nature known as berberine. You can make medicines out of that. But honestly, what it's really about, and I don't really advertise this, I don't really put it on my flyers, what it's really about, why I really get people out there, because I don't think they would show up. But I'm going to tell you tonight. You ready for it?
Yeah.
I don't think you're ready for it. The reason I answered that way years ago, I just want to get people outside. I figured it out, what it's all about, why I really like to get people outside, what it's all about underneath all of this. It's not just about food, guys. It's not just about medicine. It's about reuniting us, you, me, every individual out there, reuniting us with a long-lost lover, a lover that has been taken away from us, a lover that has been sold back to us in bits and pieces in such an adulterated form. And that is our land. Mm-hmm.